If you have any questions along the way, you can always feel free to email me. I'll put my email in the chat. You can DM me on Instagram. I have been a little bit out this week because I was sick, but normally I try to respond quickly. And you can also leave a note with the folks from JPAC, because I know we're covering a lot. It goes quickly. And I want to make sure that if you have questions, you can ask me directly. Second thing, since I'm seeing you use the chat here, how many of you were able to watch some or all of the videos that I sent you to watch? Just raise your hand or... Huh. Nobody watched the videos? Okay. Guys, that was homework. Let me put the videos in the chat here. Every week, I'm going to try to give you some videos, not as many as I did this week, but just so that you can study a singer doing something technically that we're working on. This week, I wanted to give you an overview of a lot of different things. So, let me back up again. How many of you have your journals with you? I hope everybody. Good. So this is my old journal. I hope you can see it with the background. It's filled with all kinds of like exercises and tips. And I even have gold stars. Do you guys have gold stars? Do you like gold stars? I give myself a gold star if I have done something really good. And this is, again, all of these tips that I'm giving you here are for your journals. See, I have some yoga poses. We're gonna go through a lot of things. But briefly, I guess I'm gonna back up. Again, I hope you guys are taking notes. These were the videos from the Friday, April 1st class, which are sort of the MRI videos that we discussed. And those, I think, are a really important reference because we never see the vocal cords. So please take note of the first group of videos and also of the homework videos. I'll come back to the homework videos in a minute, but I have a video today that I'd like to show you, a short video on resonance. So let me cue that up. Sorry. Let me share my screen. And just give us a minute.
This is mud water. It's all the stuff that...
There we go. So this is going to seem very technical, but I want you to understand a little bit about the resonance. And I'll also put this video in the chat for you in a moment.
You can identify some of the features of the vocal tract. Lips, tongue. This difficult to control piece of anatomy is called the velum or the soft palate, but you can think of it as the nose gate. It opens and closes, controlling the flow of air and sound up into the nasal cavity. In most people, the velum is opening and closing constantly when we speak and sing, and we're barely even aware of it. Down here, we have the larynx, which houses the vocal fold.
Now, the area at the back here that joins the nasal and the oral cavity together, this area is called the pharynx.
So I'm going to pause it there. So if you guys can, I recommend you take a screenshot of this. Let me see if I can move this down a bit. sorry, it won't let me. But this screenshot is a very useful screenshot because here you can see that you know, true side view of our instruments. Again, the teeth are very visible, the tongue, you see what a powerful muscle it is, and down how it connects to the larynx. And he just mentioned the soft palate up here and the pharynx. So everyone just take a moment and take a nice screenshot of this for your own memory. I suggest you start a folder on your phone or on your computer with some of these images that we're covering, okay?
Nasopharynx is here.
That's the nasopharynx, which goes into the nose.
Oral pharynx is here.
Oral pharynx.
Behind the mouth. And the laryngopharynx is down here because this structure here is the larynx.
Okay, I want everyone to see that as well. This is your little voice box. Now, I've suggested that you touch, if you can find, there's a little bit of a bump. It's more protruded for men. In men, it's often called the Adam's apple. Right about here, you should feel like a little ridge, a little bump. I can actually move my fingers up and down and feel it. And if you hum, you'll feel that vibrate. You can feel a little bit of a vibration. That is your voice box or your larynx. This quote here from Manuel Garcia. Manuel Garcia was one of the most famous teachers of singing.
Here is a side view of the human head showing the larynx. When we sing or speak, air comes up from the lungs and passes between the vocal folds, which vibrate to make sound. To film the vocal folds in action, a small camera is passed through the nose or mouth to sit inside the vocal tract above the larynx. This photograph shows the view from above using a nasal endoscope camera. Let's identify the different structures. The area shown at the top of the screen is the back wall of the vocal tract. At the bottom of the screen is the small leaf-shaped cartilage called the epiglottis. And below that, just out of view, is the base of the tongue. Let's focus in on the larynx itself. In the center of the screen, you can just see the windpipe or trachea, the airway that leads down into the lungs.
So I'm going to pause it there. To be clear, the V that you see on the screen of those white vocal cords, the V goes like this way, like that way, so that the point of the V is where your mouth is, and the openness of the V would be back behind your neck, yeah?
The true vocal folds, indicated here, meet in the middle to close off the airway and also to make sound. The gap between the true vocal folds is called the glottis. The true vocal folds are attached at the back to the arytenoid cartilages. These swing apart to open the folds for breathing and together to close them for phonation and swallowing. Lateral to and above the true vocal folds are the false vocal folds used for additional protection in swallowing.
Okay, so right now, everybody put your hand on your throat, like your fingers or your hand, and I want you to swallow, and I want you to feel what happens with your larynx when you swallow. It should kind of go up and down a little bit. There's a little bit of a movement. Do you feel that? Okay, good.
See the larynx in action.
So we've talked a little bit about consonants and articulators. We're going to be spending a lot of time on vowels. And I want you to just watch what happens inside the throat and on those vocal cords with the vowels E, A, A, O, U. So I'm going to pause this here. Douglas Stanley, also a very famous voice teacher, is citing. Sorry. Let's go back. For resonance cavities. they are the laryngeal pharynx. So there's an actual resonance here. When you hum, you feel it. I can feel something vibrating there. The oral pharynx, which if you remember was back here. The nasal pharynx, which we're going to talk a lot, it's also referred to as the mask area. And then the trachea and the bronchi. The trachea is the whole tube and the bronchi. And this is more for the chest voice. Yeah, those four resonance cavities. I'm going to quiz you guys. I'll send you this video so you have it as well.
Komm lieber Mai und mache die Bäume wie Winter grün.
Sorry, let me move this.
Und lass mir an dem Bache die kleinen Veilchen blühen. Wie möchte ich doch so gerne ein Veilchen wiedersehen. Ach, lieber Mai, wie gerne einmal spazieren gehen.
So do you see how there's a space here and there's also a space back here that opens depending on the vowels? I keep moving this. I'm sorry, guys, because this is taking a lot of space here. I don't know if I can go. There we go. I want to watch that again just so you see that back space right here. I want you to watch that. So the third point is very important. The shape of the resonator is not only complex, but highly variable. Each one of us have a different body. So this is just so you can understand how it varies. If the voice were a machine, how it can vary. This is the tilt of the larynx, how you would move it around, right? And then they'll show you here. Pause it there and try to bring it back to stop share. Okay, this is a lot to cover. And I know I'm getting into technical detail, but just show of hands, because again, this is the beginning of a very long course. How many of you find it interesting to watch these videos and to see the instrument? Is it kind of strange for any of you to see the instrument? Is it bizarre? Can someone tell us what that's like? Let me ask another question. How many of you had never seen the vocal cords before this class? So several of you, yeah. I remember the first time I saw my vocal cords, I brought a picture today. It was so strange for me to see this because singing actually feels very personal. It feels like something that you can't really explain. It's inextricable. It's like ethereal kind of, right? We don't really think about it as a machine or as a visual instrument, the same way we think of say a keyboard or a violin. And for that reason, it can be very difficult to take criticism or you know, we take things personally because we think it's our voice. One of the things I want to do in this class is to give you some tools to be able to cope with stage fright and cope with any criticism in auditions, because it does feel very personal when we sing. It feels like we're giving something of ourselves, but I want you to also understand that this is an instrument. It's something that you're constructing and working on, just like any athlete. And the more that you can understand how to strengthen it, and I don't want to say detach it from yourself because it should always be yourself, but understand that it's something that you can control, that you can improve on. I think that's going to help a lot with things like stage fright and receiving feedback and so forth. Does anybody want to share any comments on this? You guys are quiet this evening. What's going on? Okay, let me put that particular video in the chat for you. And then I'm gonna just touch on a few other videos very briefly this morning. And thank you for bearing with me as I'm still slowly getting myself back in shape. So I cited a bunch of videos here for you guys to watch. It looks like some of you watched the Yeba video. Yeba's riffing and her emotion in her pop singing is, to me, unrivaled. It's in my opinion, better even than Adele, because she really taps into a lot of emotion. She's using a range that is, I don't know, it's got to be at least 3 octaves, but it goes way, way up into head voice and way down into the chest voice. And she's doing it completely seamlessly. So for those of you who like pop singing and who are, we're talking about those transitions from head voice to chest voice and emotion, she is a singer to listen to very acutely. And the video I put in the chat here of her singing My Mind is the single performance that kind of like launched her. It's a really good performance. Happy Days is just one of my favorite duets. I want to play for you just snippets really of 2 or 3 other videos so you can hear a couple of different techniques. And I'm going to share my screen again. Sorry.
Mi nombre es Mia. Oh, tengo 6 años y soy paciente de sangre.
How many, before we start, how many of you have heard of the singer Ima Sumac? Ima Sumac is a Peruvian singer with a 4-octave range who basically just did whatever she wanted with her voice. Her voice is truly amazing. I'll skip into forward a little bit. Stop it there for now. Could you hear that? Yeah, oh, cool. It's really cool to see your comments here. Can someone give me some responses? I want you to think about when, here we go. One of the things that we're gonna start to do in the Friday classes is to analyze singers. And so to save some time in class, I'm gonna give you one or two performances to watch at home. And I want you to start analyzing things like the five, who can tell me again in the chat, what are the five criteria for technique? Do you guys remember? I want to see someone put it in the chat, at least one of them. Let's see if we can remember all five. And Hilda, I'm going to answer your question. Breathing, that's number one. Larynx, yep, there we go. Articulation, vocal range, and projection. Yeah, vocal range or resonance, I would say. There you go. So breathing, the larynx, which is where phonation starts. So phonation is a fancy word, but technically I'll say breathing, phonation, articulation, which is what we do with our tongue and our lips, resonance, which we're going to talk a lot about the mask, but also here in the chest resonance, and projection. Those are the five. Excellent. When we start to watch singers, I'm going to start to ask you to be the judges and you to evaluate, okay, how are they doing technically on these five? And of course, how are they doing expressively? Do you see their personalities? Are they emotional and so forth? So this is going to be a new component to our Friday sessions. And I want you to start to think analytically, because sometimes, as you've seen, we can be very hard on ourselves and very, very critical. I want you to also think about the criteria when you listen to other people, not just in a critical way, but what do they do well? So along those lines, let's see, Dee, you've got your hand up. I'm looking for someone who can tell me some things about that performance that we just viewed, technical comments about her breathing, about her range, about her resonance, articulation. She does a lot with percussive sounds. Who would like to do just a quick analysis of her technique? Getha, thank you, please.
Yeah, I hope you can hear me.
Yes.
Yes, all right. I will try to, analyze something that I heard from that video. So the breathing, absolutely fantastic. She can control that very note, especially when she started hitting the whistle, that whistle note. I had my experience, I had my whistle, I can sound my whistle but like 3 or 4 times, and then after that nothing happened. So it's an experience that I understand that we need to practice, and it connects with breathing, absolutely. And the articulation, how she delivered each word, each vowels. And I can hear from her singing that and imagine that her from the MRI vision, that she did like something from the MRI visualization. So I was like, wow. And how she opens that space for her right. Resonance can, her resonance and projection goes the same direction, in the same place, in the same yes. direction.
Yes, that is such a good analysis, Getha, thank you, because that's exactly right. She's not switching techniques or positioning. It's all kind of one column, right? From the very, very bottom of the 4 range to the very top of the 4 octave range. Thank you for that analysis. I think also when you were talking about the breathing, one of the things that's so unique to her is how she can hit the whistle tone that you're calling, the very high notes, in the staccato with such control. And the pitch is 100% accurate. It's right on that pitch. It's not above or below. And she's doing it very quickly. This is what I mean. It's really cool to watch these videos and analyze them.
Can I ask something though,
yes,
Carla?
Please.
When she hit that whistle, we can hear that ringing. does every singer have that ringing, like
a ringing? Voice, do you mean like a ringing. Shimmer? Like it's like a small vibrato or a shimmer?
Yes.
Yeah. So that is technically it's a resonance question. It's about when she's hitting the notes. Let me ask a question back to you. How do you know the difference between a scream and a singing of a high note?
From what I heard, from what I've experienced, some of my students also, the texture of the voice is different. I mean, the tone and the color switching, the vocal register, and also the sound is different.
The sound is different, absolutely. But the energy, if we talk about the energy needed to make a scream, like on like in the horror movies, you know, those really, really high-pitched screams versus singing a high note, the energy is essentially the same.
Yep.
The main difference is that you're controlling the sound.
Yep.
And in that control, you have a vibrato. So what makes it, when she goes to those very top high notes, and she has that spin or that shimmer that you're talking about, it's because she has the space. If we were looking at it in that sideways view, she has that space so that there is a space for the sound produced in
the
larynx.
Is it open? Is it always open, that space?
It's very open.
It has to be open, yes, all right.
It's very open, and we're gonna talk about this a lot. The way that I tell students to find that space is by imagining, and I have some in the kitchen I thought about bringing out. Imagine that you put an egg, a raw egg, in your mouth, vertically. And you don't want to crack the egg, because if you crack that egg in your mouth, can you imagine? It's going to be disgusting. The shell, it's horrible. It's just to think about that, right? You're like, but if you imagine having that egg here and having to sustain it, all of a sudden what happens, and of course you can see it better on the MRI machine than on me, but this soft palate and the pharyngeal opening that we're talking about, they lift. Because I have an egg in my mouth and I don't want to crack egg, right? So if I were to talk in this space, sometimes you hear people talk like this. This is an extremely open space.
Right.
Everybody, I want you to try that with your microphone off. Just try talking in this very high voice, almost like you're gonna yawn. Oh, I have an egg in my mouth. Everything is so open. That's the egg space. That is extremely open space, right? That's like the most
yawning.
Open.
It's like
you're yawning. A lot of times, exactly, people will make that analogy. Now, another way you can find the soft palate, which again, we're gonna talk about a lot next week. Take your tongue, I'll demonstrate with a pencil. But if you take your tongue, and I want you to feel with your tongue going up against the top of your mouth. All the way in the back, I kind of make a clicking sound. You should feel first the hard palate right above your teeth when it starts to go up, kind of right there. There's a hard, smooth place, right? As you keep going back, there comes a squishy part. Yeah, does everybody feel the squishy part? Now, feel that place with your tongue and start to yawn. It goes up, right? What happens, and you saw this in the MRI, is if the top of your mouth, if it's like this, when you yawn, it goes way up, like from this to this. And that's the difference if I'm talking normal or if I'm talking with my soft palate raised. That's what it sounds like. It takes everything in a very forward and pharyngeal place, right? So that is how you open that pharyngeal opening, is by lifting that soft palate. So for your books, I've given you three tips. First of all, imagine the egg in your mouth. I'm so tempted to go to my kitchen and get an egg because my voice teacher would literally have us place the eggs in our mouth just to see if we could do it. Because it, believe me, if the egg cracked, you never forgot. You never would forget the feeling. And so you can remember that feeling for the rest of your life. The egg trick, the yawn. Yawning helps, you know, immediately. And if you're singing a phrase and you think of yawning, yawning is very funny for humans. It's contagious. So if one person sees another person yawn, even if they're not sleepy, they'll start to yawn, right? We can do this talking and with the high palate raise, this kind of talking. And third is just feel that. The hard palate to the mushy part of the soft palate, yeah? Does anybody have any questions about this?
Hello, yeah. May I ask?
Like, hey, Ellen.
Yeah, I'm Ellen. I'm new in your class.
Nice to meet you.
Thank you. For this technique, is it just mainly for opera singing or is it for other styles?
That's a great question. So what I want to do is give you a full technical, toolbox. This idea of the soft palate being raised is going to help you to have a well-produced sound for almost any technique. Maybe except rock. If you're doing rock or rap, this isn't so needed. But especially if you're going to the high voice, the whistle voice, the not even whistle, the head tone, you want to have a soft palate that's lifted. And ladies, if you're going into your chest voice, equal, you need to have the soft palate lifted. The only time where maybe in a pop style or a musical theater style, the soft palate doesn't have to be so lifted is in the middle range because it's very speaky. It should sound just like you're speaking and you don't want it to sound too much like this. But if you're going up or you're going down, if I'm going down in my range, I do want that palate lifted. It's just going to give me a much more vibrant sound. Raising the palate is important because it's going to open your vibrato and it's going to give you a nice resonance. It's like the difference between a sort of what I would call a flat sound. If you know some of the speaking tones in Sondheim, he's a very nice prince. Even that I have my soft palate. He's a very nice prince. He's a prince who prepares, whatever it is. It's very chirpy. It's a very kind of flat tone versus something with line that you're going to sing. Amazing, whatever it is like that, where there's a more legato, forgive me because I'm still a little bit sick. You're going to want to have the palate lifted more for something that's got more vowels, more line, more legato. Does that make sense?
Yeah. For me personally, I have a problem with volume with my lower register. Is that also a solution for that?
Definitely. Thank you for bringing that up. We haven't gotten to number five yet, which is projection. Projection is about volume. How do you make your voice bigger? Or also if you have a big voice, how can you control it to make it more small, you know, more piano? This is the trick to that. Raising the soft palate, if you take one thing away from my class, it's probably gonna be the solution to 9 out of 10 of any dilemmas as a singer. If you can have that palate nice and raised, it's just gonna help with almost everything. So definitely we will get to that. That's kind of advanced stage five stuff, but we'll get there. Thank you, Ellen.
Thank you.
And, yeah, thank you. Karen, good to see you again.
Yeah, thank you. I have a question.
Yes.
Sometimes when, after I warm up and I actually lift my soft palate, at first I didn't understand any of this. Thank you for explaining it to us. I used to feel kind of like empty, like something was actually lifted. So I was like so confused why after I warmed up, it felt lighter to sing. But my question is, why is it so hard after lifting my soft palate to sing in my chest voice?
Well, that's probably because, I shouldn't say I haven't heard you on this yet, but what you want to do is maintain that soft palate lifted all the way up and down. So we're going to do some exercises after the break, after 9 o'clock, but do you remember that we did the vocalise, like the yodeling exercise? Right? It's the same. You want to keep the same openness. This is the first time we're talking, you guys, about like soft palate and resonance, right? We've talked about breathing. And last week we started to talk a little bit about onset, right? So this is really like the first time. I don't expect you guys to get it right away. But that feeling, particularly in the video, the first video we watched, when he talked about those five resonators, the five open places, the chest being open, the larynx being open, the pharynx being open, and then this being open, right? You want to start to move that exercise up. In a way where all of this stays open. The only thing I'm closing are my lips for the high note. So in your case, actually, Karen, you might want to start to use some exercises that go from the bottom up to find that feeling, because it sounds like you've been doing the openness in the top. Try bottom up, and if not, try top bottom. And maintain that open feeling that you have at the top as you go down. In other words, we should never think of it dropping. My teacher used to always say that the chest voice is higher than the head voice. And that sounds so funny, but when you flip it in your mind, it actually helps. Like I'm going from a, think about it this way. If you use your hand, sorry, I'm giving a lot of tips here. It's maybe too confusing. And in your hand, if you're going, the exercise is gonna be, but I'm gonna go, so that I'm moving my hand upward as I go down. Everybody just try that. It's kind of confusing at first, but you might find it different. Yeah, let me just grab the keyboard. So we're gonna go, sorry, I'm very stuffy still, but can you feel something different when you take that approach? Does anybody want to comment on that? So it's interesting because so much is psychological when we sing. This goes back to my point of why I'm trying to give you some visualization of the voice so that you see it. So much of it is in our mind. We think, oh, it's a high note. It's up here. It's high. What if we thought of the low notes as being up there? All of a sudden, it changes things. It changes our psychology around it. So a lot of singing is also going to be those kinds of psychological tricks. Great question, Karen. Does anybody else have a question? I want to watch a part of one more video, and I'm gonna talk a little bit about singing sick, and then we're gonna take a break, and then we're gonna do more. And if we don't get to all of this, I'll talk about some of it after the break. But let me just cue up the other video. So yeah, I sent you guys a lot of music to listen to. Please do it next time. I won't send you 6 videos. I'll send you like 2, but I really want to have us analyze stuff together. This is an interesting video. So this is a gentleman, a male singer. Sorry, let me cue this up. He has been called the best pop singer in the world. He is, I think, from Kazakhstan. Let's see. Oh, sorry. Where's my video? Oh boy. What just happened? I'm sorry. Oh, sorry, guys. I just had it queued up. I don't understand. I'm not so good with technology. Sorry. Oh, here it is. It's right here.
Kazakhstan, 国宝级歌手迪玛希给我们带来电影《泰坦尼克号》当中的经典曲目《我心永恒》，让我们在 电影的音乐当中感受到.
So I'm going to fast forward. This is a long song. I'm going to play some clips of it.
Dimash. Yes,
that's right. Whoever said that, you guys know him. Dimash. Forward a little bit. I just want to pause it there. I know this is like really, really good. I want you to see, right there. Do you see how open his mouth is when he goes to that top note? Let's just go back a little, right there, in there, you can see it really well. Actually, no, that was the clip I wanted, is right. Sorry. Yeah, do you see how open? Look at how much space he's got in there. It's amazing to see this close up. Thank you. Okay. Oh, sorry. Oh, you guys are like singing along. Ah, sorry. Okay, wow. So it sounds like you guys know him. Wow, a lot of responses in the chat. I love this. You guys actually know him. Who can tell me an analysis of Dimash's singing in that video? Who wants to try? Getha, did we heard from you today? I would love to call on you again, but I want to try to call on people that we haven't heard from yet. Anybody want to try? Come on. There's no right or wrong answer. Yes, Maria, hi.
Hello, Carla.
Good to see you.
Yeah, hopefully you can hear me. Well,
great.
Yeah. I would like to try to analyze the performance.
Please.
I do think he has such a good, you know, control. He can switch from, you know, his jazz voice and then go to mix. I think it's a mix. It's more of a mixed voice. And then he gets to the head voice, which is really great, I think. And from what I've heard, he sounds, I think his technique is really healthy. I did not see any discomfort in him with, you know, switching from chest voice into head voice. And then, I think that.
That's exactly right. So I could break down that video, and part of me wants to go back and break it down. He starts in a very low register, but with actually with head, like a very light kind of head tone. When he starts the song, it's very whispered, it's very quiet, it's very intimate. In the second part of the song, he goes into more operatic kind of tone. It's a mixed voice, but it does have a chest sound in it. And in that, you can hear his vibrato and you hear much stronger voice than from the beginning. And then in the third part of the song, he goes into full falsetto, and his falsetto is extremely strengthened. He has learned how to make that very full, right? So it doesn't sound wimpy. It doesn't sound small. It sounds like a strong voice, right? But because he's doing it entirely in falsetto, and you see how open he is when he's going up to those notes, super open. He's got a lot of space to do it. There's a lot of spin. The voice sounds pretty and he's got a lot of power. So he's essentially singing in like three different kinds of styles, let's say, or three different voices, but all in one. And that's what I want you guys to have, is the tools that you could in a song be able to do what he does. And I think that's what makes him so extraordinary, is he has a lot of tools, right? Does that make sense? His breathing is very, very good. Yeah. Yes, go ahead.
I also have a question. I consider myself that I can mix very well, but it's mostly head dominant mix, because I think it's easier. I think it's my comfort zone. I use that all the time, you know, like Anna song from Frozen, that kind of song. Do you think that it's a more sustainable way of singing? If you get what I mean. I mean, I've heard that, you know, instead of belting your heart out with, you know, full chest voice, I heard it's really more sustainable if you do that with, you know, chest dominant mix or head dominant mix.
I'm not sure I understand the question. Sorry. Can you ask the question one more time?
Sorry.
No, it's okay. I just want to understand.
Communicating. I personally use mixed voice like almost all the time, every time I sing. I think it's my, you know, comfort zone when it comes to singing with my mixed voice. My question is actually, do you think that, is there any way that we can try to strengthen our mix so it's not just, you know, head dominant mix or just
No. Mix? I think, look, from my perspective, and this is uniquely personal to me, I actually think the mixed voice is the best, because let me put it this way. I think that all singing has to be a mix. There are very few times that something is going to be pure head tone. The only times that it's pure head tone, in my opinion, is pure whistle tone. Like Mariah Carey, when she goes up to those really, really high notes and it's absolute pure whistle, that's not mixed. That's pure whistle. And a very flat chest voice that's not mixed would be the other extreme of it. But sometimes the mix is a 90%, 10% mix. And sometimes the mix is a 50-50 mix. But we're always mixing. And the reason for that, I'm going to get more technical on this, but when we talked about those resonators, the four areas of resonance, right? We talked about the chest, the pharynx, the larynx, the pharynx, and the nasals, right? We just introduced that concept today. Where this resonates is what gives you the mixes. And there are very few times that you want only one resonator. Most of the times you want all of the resonators. So therefore, every sound should be some degree of a mix. But this is very, very technical. I think for your purposes, we'll find it when I hear you sing, we'll find it more. And I'm happy to hear you do some things so that we can analyze that. Singing in a mixed voice is not dangerous. Singing in a pure voice is more dangerous. But believe me when I say very few times will you hear just pure, like pure whistle. You know, you can't sing an entire song on pure whistle. I mean, maybe one song, but like at some point you've got to come down from that, right? Okay, guys, I think, why don't we do this? Why don't we take our break now? And then I'm going to go over some stuff about being sick and then we'll get to some exercises. Does that sound okay? I know this is a lot of like analysis and watching videos, but it's part of like the learning process here. And I hope you're enjoying it as much as I am. Cool. Let's come back in 5 minutes, which will be 9 a.m. my time. Will be 8 p.m. your time, I think. Great. All right, 5 minutes.
Thank you, Carla.
Welcome back, everyone. Welcome back. It's good to have a little break. I know what we do is really intense, and you know, it's funny because I haven't met you in person, but I feel like I'm getting to know you, and I hope that you feel that you're getting to know me. I'm pretty casual, and I think first and foremost, this should all be very fun. So I hope you're having fun. I missed you guys. It was kind of weird being sick. I'm going to go over a whole bunch of stuff now on being sick, and there's something else I wanted to say. Yes, make sure you do the attendance. I will be sending videos for next week to watch. I guess it'll come to me. Right. There's a question about the keyboard. I'll start with that. So I'm going to take about the next 10 or 15 minutes and just talk you through all the tips and tricks that I have acquired over the years about being sick and what to do. And I guess I'll disclose to you guys that this particular week was challenging for me because I have not been sick in 2.5 years. Which has been amazing for me. COVID, I have not gotten COVID, thankfully, but you know, from the point that I've had to wear a mask, I never got sick. So prior to that, when I was singing professionally and touring a lot, I was sick all the time, partially because I have allergies, I have asthma, and I was traveling nonstop. And so, as you know, like when you're exposed to different conditions, different areas, the stress, et cetera, it can be very hard to stay healthy. So 99% of my job, once I got the gig, was staying healthy. Because if you are not healthy, then you have to cancel the gig. And if you cancel the gig, you don't get paid. And it's very sad. And you don't get to perform, which is terrible. So in this case of this week, I have a performance on Sunday, the day after tomorrow. And so I feel it's a good case study for all of us because when I, I'm so sorry. Sorry. I think his dog walker's coming. Sorry, Grizzly. Very energetic. Yes, okay. He's going for a walk. Thank you. So on Sunday morning, in the middle of our group, I woke up on Sunday, which we started the classes at 8 a.m. my time. I woke up at 7 and I could feel like, oh, something is not right. Usually when I first feel that way, my first line of defense, and I recommend all of you write this down, is I have zinc. I do these zinc tablets, high levels of zinc. Number two, vitamin C. And I just drink a lot of water. So that's my normal, like, first thing is like, if I feel the scratchy throat or the nose or just tired, I immediately go to like massive quantities of zinc and vitamin C, not a little bit, a lot. There's something called Zicam, which is what I buy here, but you can just buy regular zinc or vitamin C. By the time it was noon, so we finished the class early. By the time it was noon, I had a fever, high fever, and I was like delirious. I slept all day on Sunday. I slept all day on Monday. I slept all day on Tuesday. I had a fever of 101 degrees. I had a yellow stuff coming out. So I knew it was an infection. At the point when, and you have to sort of learn to diagnose yourself. If there is yellow of anything coming out of my sinuses or that I'm coughing up, usually that means it's an infection. And because I've been dealing with infections my whole life, sinus infections, I know that normally nothing is going to get rid of it unless it's like an antibiotic. I don't recommend antibiotics all the time because they're tough on your stomach and they can really harm they can harm your system if you take them all the time. But in my case, knowing I have a concert the day after tomorrow, I called my doctor, went to see her, and she gave me the antibiotic. Aside from that, the other things, super important. Let me grab the one, sorry. Sorry, I have like a million things here and I thought I'd gotten this. So last week, I think I talked to you guys about the steamers, right? This is the steamer that I swear by. It's a little CVS is our pharmacy here steamer. And I'm gonna just take off my background so you guys can see everything. Well, yeah, now that Grizzly won't interrupt. Okay, so this is the way it works. There's a cord, plugs in to the wall. You have to sort of be careful with the cord, you know, that you don't bump it or something and the water comes out, but you fill this part here. You can see it's like, you know, about an inch of water goes inside. You fill it with water. So I would first obviously plug it in. Put some water inside of it, turn the light on. Well, I should back up. This goes on top of this. So once there's water inside, you just turn this and you can control how much steam comes out with this. And then this goes on top of that and you hit the on button, right? And then I just sit and I steam. I've done this for hours in the last week. Now, most of you can hear my speaking voice is okay, right? It doesn't sound like I'm sick. Doesn't sound like I had a fever yesterday. Maybe it looks a little bit like I did, but I had to make the decision yesterday, will I still do my concert on Sunday? And I said yes. So I'm very nervous because I have to do a solo recital on Sunday, which means about an hour and 15 minutes of singing by myself, which is different from doing a musical theater or something where you might have one number or two numbers. And I did that because I was really careful with the steaming and I think that I'll be okay. Yes, can you put aromatherapy? Yes. So what I find works well, if you have laryngitis, I do not have laryngitis. Laryngitis would be when you actually can't speak. Your vocal cords, those two white things we saw, become so swollen that they cannot come together and you're just completely hoarse. You can put a little bit, remember I told you, a tiny amount in something like this, a quarter of a teaspoon of Vicks Vapor Rub inside. The menthol from that will take the swelling down, but don't put too much because it can really burn if you put too much. And then just steam. Every professional singer I know, every student singer I know has one of these. In the US, this costs about $30, $35. I mean, this is a new one, but the old one I had for 20 years. You wanna make sure you wash this part. I always wash this part and sorry, and now it's kind of stuck on there. This part comes off. I always wash these well. And on the inside, I wipe this down so that it's clean because you don't want to be inhaling something that's dirty, obviously. And I will steam an hour in the morning, an hour in the afternoon, an hour at night, or 20 minutes at a time if I'm sick. Now, before a show, I will definitely steam for 20 minutes. Steaming will take all of the swelling down in your throat. In that pharyngeal cavity that we saw on the MRI, all of that, the steaming naturally takes the swelling down. So I don't know about olbus oil. I don't know what that is. If you want to just send me a picture of the ingredients, I can definitely give you some insight on that. And as I said, most singers, we learn a lot of tips from older singers who teach us or teachers. These are the tips that my teachers have given me. Definitely a good thing to get. Now, here's another version. This is a newer version. It's called My Pure Mist. I see these everywhere. It's more expensive. This is like $100. It's wireless, so you don't have the wire. Now, you do have to plug in a wire here, same kind of cord, to charge it. But once it's charged, it's wireless. So if you're on an airplane or you're backstage in the wings or whatever, it's convenient in that it's wireless. Same thing, it has this face, and you put the water. Some of you might be wondering, how do you put the water in? You have to put the water in this little hole. There's a special water thing that comes with it. These capsules of water, because the water is already purified. And the water goes in here. It's very easy. And you just hold it and you can make it. There's a temperature gauge. I mean, this turns it on. I don't think it's charged right now. So sorry. And then this controls the temperature if you want more warm or colder mists. And it's very convenient, but it is a little bit more expensive. You can also do this for free, or essentially for free. You can get a pot, just like a regular pot. I can go in my kitchen and grab one, fill it with water, not too much, maybe I would say 2 to 3 cups, put it on the stove, let it come to a bubble so that it's boiling, but really be careful. Then you take it off the stove, you put it on the table, and you want to take like a blanket or a towel, put it over your head, and just like go like this and steam. And the reason for the towel is that the steam stays inside, right? It stays inside that bubble. I'm going to be very honest with you. I used to do that method. And one time I accidentally bumped my elbow on the pot and I poured the boiling water onto my legs. And I had to go to the hospital. It was a really serious burn accident. So, and this has happened, unfortunately, to many singers who, when I was a student, you know, I didn't have a lot of money. I didn't buy the $20, $30 one. And yeah, that was bad. So if you do this method, please be safe. It's very easy to get kind of, it's dark in there and you lose sight of things, or just be careful. But these two are great. They're great. Now, I recommend you don't share them if you can, like definitely just for hygienic purposes, especially if you're sick. If you do share one, just clean it, like really wash it and make sure it's well cleaned. Now, other things that I use. I bought this one this week because I've been sick. Mostly what I feel right now, and I'm still like sneezing and stuff, is it's like stuck in my sinuses. So this is called a nasal wash. This costs, I think, $10. And this is what it looks like. It's a little bottle like this. You unscrew it. I would fill it with bottled water. I want to make sure that my water is like not sink water. And this, that you can read about this, neti pots or nasal washes, this is called a nasal wash, have come under attack recently because if you're not using clean water, it can make things much worse. So bottled water, you put it, now you put the bottled water in there, and this one comes with a whole bunch of these little packets. I love these packets. These packets are called sinus wash, and they're just salt. Saline packets. Can you see that? Kind of. So I usually, for something like this, if I'm sick, I might use 2. It's going to hurt a little bit because it's salty, but I will probably put 2 packets in here. And with the water, then, you know, close the cap and shake it a lot. Now, this gets gross, guys. Remember the flared nostrils? You put this in one nostril, you squeeze here, and the water will go around and out of the other nostril. It's really gross, but it washes everything and it comes out. And if you're sick like me, things will come out and it will hurt because it's salt water. So it's like, you know, maybe start with one packet. Yeah. And then I will, you know, blow my nose and I'll do it the other way. You have to tilt your head a little bit so that it comes out the other way. So make sure, you know, you don't want to go like this because then it will come down the back of your throat and that feels disgusting. There are other systems of this there that look more like pots. I like this system because you squeeze so you can kind of control the pressure a little bit that way. A lot of people who have allergies and who are not like sick, like right now I have a cold, but a lot of people with allergies will just use this all the time because they swear it helps their allergies. So these three for me are like the most important. I'll be honest, I like this one more than I like this one. I like this one a lot. I don't know. It's gives me the best steam that helps. This one is good. I think it's a little pricey, $100. Like, yeah, it's nice if I'm on an airplane. It's nice if I need something cordless, like backstage. But I don't, you know, most of the time I'm not going to use this backstage because I have makeup on. And so, I mean, it's fancy. You know, I got it because I travel a lot. This is a must have. It's just a must have. There's a bunch of different versions. Now, when you're finished, again, make sure you wash these. This can go in the dishwasher. You can wash it with soap. Like, just make sure that it stays really clean. Now, another tip, these little packets. I always have these packets with me. And if I don't have these packets, I have salt or salt packets. Salt is a singer's best friend. Because what I do, I've talked a lot about like the upper cleaning of the sinuses with these things. But now I want to talk about the throat. Anytime I'm singing, I want to make sure that my throat has as little inflammation as possible. So if my throat feels like there's some swelling, like there's some, maybe I sang too much, or maybe I'm starting to feel some laryngitis, my first thing to do is gargle with salt water. So these are great because I can just put them in my purse. And I'll take a little bit of water and put, you know, one or two of these. And I really gargle. Like I gargle for a good 10 minutes, like really getting that in there. And that the salt is an anti-inflammatory, a natural one. And it will take the swelling down in your larynx and in your throat. It also kind of helps to sterilize the environment. So I keep these in my bag wherever I go. They're really convenient, but you can also get just salt packets or a little salt shaker. It doesn't have to be these things. This is a must do. Gargling is amazing. Now, the other thing I always do is, you can see this here. Probably can't see it on the, I don't know how to show this to you. This is just lemon juice. So I just take the lemon, I squeeze it. I usually do about one lemon per cup. Doesn't taste great. It's very lemony. Yeah, it's a little citrusy today, but it does clear my throat. Sometimes I will gargle with salt and lemon, and boy, oh boy, just wakes everything up. I could put sugar in here. I actually prefer to put honey. If I put a little bit of honey, it kind of coats my throat, but this is the best tea when you're sick. I recommend lemon because it's just easy. You buy a lemon, you cut it, you squeeze it, you put it in. Ginger, if you can do it, buy the ginger, peel the ginger, put the ginger, like two big chunks of ginger in a pot with some boiling water, and then let it sit like overnight. Really let the juices from the ginger be in the pot. That is unbelievably good, but you have to peel the ginger, cut up the ginger and let it sit for at least 6 hours. That's another, like my voice teacher used to swear by that. And then you take the mixture from that ginger, maybe put some lemon, maybe put some honey, gargle it, drink it, just take it all the time. She really swore by that. So let's see, these are all these tips. I told you I have a lot of tips on this. now I'm going to get into other things. This is also like super convenient. This is just the saline salt spray. I buy this at the drugstore. You can see it's this one's Arm & Hammer brand, but you can buy these. I've bought these in Asia. I've bought them in Europe. I've bought them everywhere. Normally, if you want a tip, you can get the baby kind because they have a slightly smaller. So if you're afraid of doing this for the first kind, get the ones for babies. They're a little more gentle. This is not the gentle one. This is the professional kind, I guess. And again, you just put it in here. Now this, it's salty. It definitely stings a little bit when it goes up. But I would just do this. I wouldn't necessarily irrigate. I wouldn't necessarily have it come out the other side, but I would just do this a little bit in both nostrils to clean. It's convenient. You can have it in a bag. If I can't have all of the other things, this is always a very good thing to have. So yeah, let me take a moment here. Cracked voice problems. If you're cracking on your voice and you're sick, it's a sign of swelling. My biggest thing would be if you're cracking, stop singing, stop talking. I literally, guys, have not spoken for 3 days. No, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. Yeah. And most of Sunday, my husband hasn't heard me speak. I went on complete vocal rest and it's the only reason I can be speaking today. That I should have said that from the beginning. That's number one. If you're sick, stop talking. It's your instrument. So you have to stop using it. The other tip I will say from medicine, I'm going to get to medicine now. A few more tips. This is it's called Fluco. I'll write it in the chat. This is a medicine spray. I'm supposed to do this twice here, kind of. It doesn't hurt. It's a steroid. It's got some cortisone in it. So let me write this in the chat. So I have to get this from my doctor. This is for people with allergies. I have a lot of allergies. And this just helps me. I don't take it all year, but now we have a lot of like flowers and trees. This really, 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 really helps for medicine. Again, you need a prescription for this, but this is a big, good one. I'm going to talk a little bit about prednisone or cortisone. Okay, so the first thing when you're sick and your voice is going in laryngitis, I told you, first thing, gargle with salt, gargle with salt and lemon, stop talking. Use the steamers, maybe put a little bit of menthol in there, a little Vicks VapoRub. If it's not getting better, try taking Advil, try taking ibuprofen. I think that's how you spell it. I would probably take like the maximum dose. That's an anti-inflammatory. That might help. If you are really, really, really sick, you can take something called methylprednisone, which is again, is prescription, and it's a tapered pack. So like I'm taking a very, very low dose of this because I have a performance on Sunday. I'm taking, you can see, instead of starting at the main dose, I'm starting on the low dose. Tomorrow I'll take this one, Sunday I'll take that one, and that's it. Again, because I know my body and my doctor knows me, and I'm asthmatic. This will help to take swelling down. It's cortisone, it's a steroid, but it helps to take swelling down here. And if you have asthma or if you have major allergies, I don't recommend it. It's a last option. But for me, because I'm asthmatic, I do have to take it once in a while to deal with my asthma issues. So this is, and I would recommend a very low dose, like under 40 mg and tapered. Most ENT doctors, and ENT is the kind of doctors that treat us, ears, nose, throat, ENT, right? ENT doctors are the ones to see for singers. I'm giving you guys a lot of medicinal advice. Dayquil is generally seen as a really good, popular over-the-counter thing for colds. So I would just recommend this if you have, you know, cold-like symptoms. Basically has some pain reliever and a cough suppressant. This is also just a go-to. A lot of people use something called guaifenesin. Guaifenesin is also like a mucus thinner. So if you have a lot of stuffiness and maybe it's not coming out, guaifenesin really will give you kind of, it'll start to come out. And that's a good medicine to take too. Now, are you guys ready for more? Is this too much? I'm going through all of my tricks. Just a couple of more. Finally, this is a very popular thing in sort of the Broadway community. It's called the entertainer's secrets. It's if you have a dry throat. So this is a spray. I just sprayed it. It tastes good. It tastes kind of like licorice. And it, it just has like very homeopathic ingredients, but it kind of helps to soothe a sore throat. So there are different things like this. This says for dry throat and hoarse voice. I like it. I generally keep it if I need to just, you know, if I'm singing like a show like Carmen, which is nonstop, and I go off in the wings really quick and I just spray. It's like, it's kind of like having a little bit of honey or something on your throat. It really feels good. Singer or entertainer secret. I think there's also one called singer secret or something like that. So there are a couple out there. Homeopathic stuff. I love this. This in particular is called Arum Triphellium. So this is for a hoarse voice. This is for laryngitis. If you have laryngitis, this will help. I'm gonna write it in the chat here. And I like to take the 30C count and I take 6 pills 3 times per day. It's homeopathic, you don't need a prescription for this. And the way it works is you turn the bottom. Like for each time I turn, a little bubble comes out. So I'll turn it and I'll take 6. I'm not going to turn all of them. And I just pop the top off and you put them under your tongue and you let it dissolve. This is like gold. Like for sure, this has saved me many performances. I always have some of this ready to go. In the States, you can buy this for like $6 or $7 and this will last for a while. So this is a very, very, very good tip. Okay, what else? Final tip. Sorry, I'm going through all of mine here. This is called a nebulizer. Now, a lot of musical theater people do this. I do this because I am asthmatic. So it's another gadget. I have to put a liquid inside that is, I didn't bring my liquids. It's a little liquid thing I put in that has like asthma solution. I forget the name of it, but it's medicinal and my doctor gives it to me. Some people just put their own kind of water and homeopathy things in here, put it in, put the cap on. It's battery operated. Right now, nothing's gonna happen. The battery is down in here. Yeah, sorry. It's a little tricky to get it out. You can see the batteries, right? So no cords. This is another thing that I always do pack in my bags. Right. And then once I hit the button, this yellow light will come on. You'll see it, but there's no liquid in there. The liquid, when it comes in, goes out of here. And I inhale it. And that does go directly on my cords and in my chest. So you could put like salt water in here and inhale it. It's, to me, it's kind of the same as gargling. So you don't need a fancy machine for it. But if you're asthmatic or you have allergies, this is a lifesaver. Literally, I can't really perform without this as an asthmatic. And I've worked with a lot of different doctors on my asthma. The difference for me is I have a top C when I use this. When I don't use it, I have a top A. So I need it. Yeah, just opens up my lungs. Definitely helps with laryngeal swelling. This is called nebulizer. The brand is Omron. Let me see. I'll put it in here. I don't know how much these cost now. I bought mine. Actually, to be honest, my insurance covered it. I want to say it's probably 100 or 150. Yeah. So I'm trying to give you guys a lot of tips here. You should see my counter. Someone asked me about my keyboard also. Believe it or not, I bought this at a garage sale. It's also battery operated. It's like one of these old ones. Anytime I tell my friends, if you see one or someone's getting rid of them, tell me. It's just really easy. I think it's a Casio. You know, I turn it on. I have my basic notes. I can put it in my luggage. But to be honest, like I use the app on my phone too. I think I told you guys about this one. Yeah, it just, this is the app. It's free. Oh, what's going on here? Sorry. So like this works. My volume is way down, but like this works fine, you know? So there's a lot that you can do now. There's metronomes also you can put on here. Okay, this is a lot. Who has a question? Like, how can I help you understand all that I just put out there? Because I'm sure you must have questions, this crazy amount of stuff. Yes, COVID has been tough for singers. I was really afraid I had COVID this week because I had a lot of the symptoms. I think it's just like the hardest thing is the psychology, because I always say being sick for a singer is like a bird with clipped wings. Like it just sucks. And you know, you're so worried. It takes a lot of time to get better. And those who I know that have struggled after COVID, it's just taken time. Like they have to really rest and commit to resting. And, you know, sometimes it takes weeks, but everyone I know has recovered. It just took them a long time. Any other questions? Yes. Ashley. Hi.
Hi, Carla.
Hi.
So I've been really concerned with my vocal health, because I recently have what they call regular gigs here. So every Tuesday I sing at like a bar, and I'm also teaching all day. And truly the pollution in Jakarta is really bad. When I first came here, I would get sick, like within 3 days, I would have like sinus things. And so thank you for all of the tips. But I'm wondering specifically, what would you do for if you have like kind of muscle strain, if that's what that is? And also, what about smoke damage? Because there's also a lot of smoking and the smoke in the air and the pollution. So yeah, maybe smoke damage. How would you rectify that situation, as well as like the strain on, is it your muscles or is it
the larynx? Yeah, that's a great question, Ashley. I mean, look, to be honest, that is toxic for singers. It's so, so, so hard. I've sung a lot in countries where there's high smoking and pollution. I've sung a lot in China, which I struggled with so much. There's another gadget I didn't bring up, but I could go run down and get it. So my feeling is that if you're living in a place with a high pollution rate, the first thing is if you can't measure it, you can't improve it, right? Like if you have no metrics, give me 30 seconds. I'm gonna go get one more tool because I think this is gonna help.
Unless, don't tell me to do things. Must entertain, must entertain. Don't tell Carla, you guys. I also have been merokok too much. It's Jakarta, don't tell me.
Okay, by the way, I found another neti pot. This is another one. I put the salt things inside of it. But just so you know, this is like another option, another style. You put the water in, obviously not with the salt things. It goes this way, it goes that way, but you can't squeeze this, which I like the squeezy one better. Okay, Ashley, to your point. Sorry, I have so many gadgets, but this is this machine. Which is not that expensive here. I think this might've cost $20 or $30. There are cheaper versions, way cheaper, like $5, $10 versions. And here's what you do. You blow into this and it tells you where your lung capacity is. So because I'm asthmatic, I have this, but I actually think this is good for any singer to have. And this is like a digital fancy one. So here's what I do. Then it beeps and it tells me I am at 346. That is not a good number. I should be over 450. I have not taken my asthma medicine today, but this is like, I know, okay, my lungs are not at the capacity that I need to sing well. So then I'll probably go and nebulize or do my asthma medicine, and guaranteed, because I've done this so many, I did this once for 60 days to test myself straight. I'm usually around 375. Today I'm low. And after I nebulize, I'm always in 430 to 450 range. So my advice to you would be to get something, maybe it doesn't have to be this fancy, and measure your breathing like in the morning and at night, and start to take track of like, okay, is it worse after I'm in a smoky place? Because this is about your lungs, like how are your lungs doing, right? And I hate to say it, but I mean, when I think of pollution, the first thing I think of is, yeah, your lungs. And are you gonna need something to open your lungs from the pollution? Because essentially pollution is like secondhand smoke, right? So there are a few different things that you can do. First of all, you can try to prevent yourself from inhaling the smoke when you go out by wearing a mask. I know there are a lot of different masks now, you know, masks that can try to keep some of the smoke out. It can be tedious. I mean, we're all kind of tired of wearing masks, but you can't wear a mask when you sing. So if you're in a bar and you're singing, like you're gonna end up inhaling some of it. But the prevention side, wear a mask as much as possible. Be healthy as much as possible with your vocal health, et cetera. Now, when you're in that kind of singing environment, I would say, can you use a microphone? Are you using a microphone? Try to take as much of the stress off of your cords in terms of the projection, so that you are saving as much as possible. And then I would take a look at where are your lungs afterward and with a machine like this. Could you benefit from an inhaler? Could you benefit from, and again, I'm not trying to advocate medicine, but you do want to make sure that you're, you know, balancing this in a healthy way. Steaming also will help for sure, but the swelling on your cords, there's very little you can do about that. Steaming, ibuprofen, you know, something like this, if you're feeling like it's starting to get hoarse, the RM that I mentioned. And then cortisone, which you don't want to be taking cortisone regularly. So I would just start by measuring how your breathing is doing and start to take stock of like, when do you feel better? When do you feel worse? In terms of the muscles, anytime that you sing on a strain, like if your cords are swollen, if your muscles are strained and you're singing on them, you're going to damage them more. Like it's going to take you longer to recover. It's just like an athlete. Say you had a sprained ankle and then you're like, okay, well, I can still kind of run. so I'm going to go do this marathon. Well, then you're risking that you're going to, you know, sprain the ankle further and maybe have other subsequent injuries. So if you can, it's always better, don't sing sick, like just don't do it, you know? But, you know, are we always at our ideal? If you're dealing with atmospheric kinds of issues, there's going to be a lot that's out of your control. So I don't know, if you give me more specifics, maybe I can try to give you more specifics, but these are kind of general tips, I guess.
Thank you. So what is that machine that you measured your lung capacity? Does that have a name?
Yeah, this is called brand, I guess it's Micro Life. And it's like, just comes in like this little kit. Trying to see if there's, yeah, I always keep these. I think it's just called Micro Life. And I just like it because it's digital, but there are so many of these online. There's one that just has this little bubble. Let me see if I can find one really quickly here. Oh yeah, there's some that are like, this is like the traditional one. I'm gonna put two in the chat. These are the ones that I often see when I go to the doctors. And it's just super similar to the exercises we've done with the candle. Where you're like trying to blow and get the bubble up. This is called, yeah, peak flow meter. That's what these are called, peak flow meters. This is another one. I think if you go to like a medical supply store, you can find these there. And yeah, I think it's just really important. Like if you think you're having an issue, measure it, see, you know, what is the data? And then that way you can start to improve it. Like, you know, if you're not scoring, I mean, you can see on the cover of this, it says 455. Like mine was like 3 something, like I know I'm not where I should be. Then you go, okay, well, there's an issue there. And how do I improve it? Test a couple different days, try different environmental things. But at a certain moment, you might want to go to a doctor and say, look, I am having this issue. Can you help me? And get on some kind of inhaler or get on some kind of medication that could help.
All right. One thing also kind of like technical, that after, you know, years of doing gigs, making sure that I can hear myself, because I am using a microphone, and if I have in-ear monitors or the monitors, doing that check has been really helpful, because I don't have to scream, because I know what my volume is at. So I like always have to make sure I take my time right during those checks.
Yeah, I think that's another huge thing, and we haven't talked about that as much, but thanks for bringing it up. It's just standing up for yourself. And you don't have to seem like a diva about it, but just saying like, okay, here's what I need for a good performance. I hope you can help me do this because I want to give the best performance possible. I need a mic check. I need an in-ear monitor. I need like as much information as you can know. I want my levels to be here. So like, I wouldn't know my mic levels, but I have a really good engineer I trust. Maybe I would call him and be like, hey, Chris, I'm going on a gig, like, can you help me so that I can know the information to communicate to the engineers or the soundboard guys, like, so that I can do my best, like as much information as you can have going in and saying, here, guys, this is what works really well for me. I really appreciate your support. Make their job simple so that like they can help you to do your best. I think that's always like a big thing. And don't be apologetic about it. Like if, you know, from my standpoint, I remember being many times in a room where people were smoking and I was singing, and I would have to say, guys, it's really hard for me to sing if you're smoking in this room, like 2 feet away from me, you know, and I don't want to seem like a diva, but how do you have that conversation? And like, you know, that's a very tricky thing to negotiate. and this is going to come more into like charisma and being honest. It's one thing if you say, oh, I'm not going to perform if anyone has their phones up. I have no recordings, no smoking, no blah, blah, blah. It's another if you go, hey, I'm so excited to be here. Thank you so much. I want to do my best for you. And I'm, you know, smoke really affects me. So I'm just wondering, like, for the next few songs, if you could please, you know, just feel free to go outside and smoke and we'll miss you in here. But I want to try to keep it, you know, to in a smoking free environment so I can do my best for you. Thank you so much. I really appreciate that. It means a lot to me. Like, it's all about the language, I think, that we use and understanding these things too. It's very, very hard to navigate, but I do encourage you to stand up for yourself because you're doing it for everybody's interest to give your best performance, right?
Thank you so much, Carla. I wrote down some things to purchase and to do. Thank you.
Thank you. It's a great question. Any other questions? Like, this is, I guess we'll just make today like the session where we talk about all the health stuff. Alexandra, how are you?
Carla, I'm sick. So if I sound nasally, oh,
I'm so sorry.
It's fine. Luckily, it's not COVID. So since we're on the topic of vocal health, I was wondering, are there like any like daily like sort of habits or like anything mundane that we can do to like maintain our vocal health?
Definitely. I mean, if I'm in a singing mode or an auditioning mode, I would say the number one biggest thing is thinking about how I use my voice. So for instance, there's some absolute no-nos. I won't go to a smoky bar. I mean, I just won't do it because I know the next day I'll be hoarse. That's me. Some of you might be able to do that and have no problem. But for me, absolute no-no. I won't go to a noisy club or a noisy restaurant. Because if I do that, then I'm going to have to push my voice and I'll probably feel it the next day. I won't go to a sports game, also very noisy environment, or a concert that's super noisy. I'll monitor how much speaking I'm doing. And when I speak, I will try to speak in a lighter voice. If I were talking all day in a gravel like this, see how like tight and compressed the speaking voice is? That's not good. That's not healthy. And that will hurt my voice also. So I'll think about the way in which I'm speaking and try to speak in a way that's healthy. Secondly, I will always warm up in the morning. I'll always take a long hot shower. The heat from the shower is the sort of steam for me. Maybe do some, just kind of like warm up, do a little bit of, you know, general stretching, because I know that's going to help me carry my voice throughout the day with just speaking. Those are definite like must do's for any time of good vocal health. No screaming. I will not scream or push my voice. That I just can't recover from it well. Generally, I always have little candies. I love candy, but I always have like little lozenges, honey lozenge, just trying to stay hydrated, drink a lot of water, have a little lozenge. That kind of keeps things lubricated. Yeah, I probably would avoid like drinking alcohol or spicy food just because of GERD. We didn't talk a lot about GERD today. GERD is acid reflux. I do take an acid reflux pill every morning. And I try to avoid alcohol. I love spicy food, so that's hard, but I'll try to have it in proportion. And I will also try to avoid too much coffee. Caffeine can activate that too. Fisherman's friend, I'm glad I see this in the chat. Great, I always have some, I have some right in my other room. Yeah, those are very, very good tips also. What other questions does anyone have about this? We might as well, Grethers are my favorite. Grethers are by far my favorite. They're kind of pricey, but they're really, really, really good. yeah, I'm all out of breathers. I always have breathers and I just saying to myself, I have to order some. Yeah, breathers are fantastic. Anything with honey in it, honey is just so natural and it's also an anti-inflammatory. I have friends who say that you should always have the honey from where you're from, because it's like a natural, the honeybees from where you're from have like the natural sort of elements that need to boost up your immune system to where you are. So having local honey is supposedly very, very good for your health. Any other questions? Yes, Natalia.
Okay, hi again, Carla.
Hi.
Okay, I asked the question, is it okay?
Yes, please.
First, it's about the voice too. Like, I have grade 2, and also I already get COVID for the second time, so it's really makes my voice like worse. So I cannot hit. Sometimes I cannot hit the high note. And it feels like it's really. I don't know. I feel like angry and sad because of that. So I don't know. Like, yeah. And then my work as a trainer, it's need me to talk a lot. Right, so I think I cannot do the vocal rest, and also for the GERD, I already not to drink coffee, alcohol, or spicy food, right, like that. But it's still really reflux. So I don't know, like I already, it already makes my vocal damage. Like I already have to vocal rest for like about a month, and but it's still reflux again and again. So like I don't know how.
Well, okay, so this is a good question. One of the things is also determining at what point should you see a doctor. Have you been scoped? And by scoped, I mean this thing, the photo. Have you gone to an ENT?
Maybe I have, but like she said that it's because my acid reflux. So I need to take the vocal rest, but after that, it's always reflux, and reflux again. And plus, right now I got COVID for the second time, so it feels like I breathe like asthma people, but I don't have asthma. So it's really, really like.
So I would say, first of all, maybe you just need a rest, because if you got COVID for the second time and you have all of these things, my first recommendation would be: can you take like a long rest, like a week rest or 4 or 5 days, just vocal rest, sleeping, like really, really rest. And then if you don't notice a difference after that, I would suggest, and I'm assuming because you guys have better healthcare than for us. In other words, when I go to see an ENT, I have to pay out of pocket. But if you have access to go to see an ENT, first of all, you should all go to see an ENT, ear, nose, throat doctor, right? ENT is ear, nose, throat doctor. You should see this doctor when you're healthy, because the healthy, when you go and you're healthy, then they have an image of your cords healthy. Remember I said no cords, no one is the same. So they can't compare your vocal cords to my vocal cords, but they can compare your vocal cords healthy to when you're sick. So all of you, if you're healthy, go to the ENT when you're healthy. They'll take the image, they'll see your cords, and then you'll have a lot of information from that. And then when you're sick, go. Now, in some cases, and we didn't talk about these kind of extreme cases, but they happen. They happen much more often than you think. You can actually have a damaged vocal cord. And maybe for the next time, I'll show you guys some. Damaged vocal cords is like a polyp or a nodule. You know, Adele had to have a vocal surgery because she had them. John Mayer, many, many, many pop singers, classical singers, musical theater singers have had to have vocal surgery because on the vocal cord, instead of having these two white cords, there becomes like, there comes like a lump or a callus or something, some swelling. I'll show you some pictures for next time. And you could not even know you have that, right? You just think, oh, it's hoarse, or I have acid reflux. And the more you sing and the more you go on and you don't know you have it, can be very, very damaging. So I'm not saying you have this, Natalia. I think you just need a good long rest. Some Nexium would be my recommendation for GERD. If you can take even 2 Nexium in the morning and 2 Nexium at night, you could also try something called Gaviscon, which is a liquid, maybe Nexium in the morning and Gaviscon at night, but a lot of rest. Yes, Julie Andrews had the surgery and it did damage her. Now, Julie Andrews had the surgery many years ago. Surgeries have gotten much better, but still, all of you, I do strongly recommend go see an ENT when you're healthy and when you're sick, so that they have this different view, and it'll give you a view of your instrument too. You would be surprised how many people I know, I would say almost everyone I know at some point has had something. A lot of times if you have a polyp or a little thing, it goes away on its own. I have had a very small kind of blister, let's say, and it went away completely on its own. I didn't need a surgery, but I did need a rest, a long rest. So, you know, it's very, very good to, when things really feel like they're not right, you notice, oh, I don't have the high notes I used to have, and I'm doing everything, and but it's just not right. Why not? Go to see the ENT. Probably your insurance, or I hope that the health plan there will cover the expense, and just takes a few hours. They usually put the camera up the nose. Sometimes it goes in the mouth. It doesn't really hurt. It's a little uncomfortable, but it's really worth it. I go about once a year or once every 2 years, and I just want to make sure, like, oh, how are the cords doing? You know, and it's a very important thing for us because we don't see the instrument. So yeah, good question.
Thank you, Carla. I have one question. Is it okay?
Yeah, of course.
It's not about the vocal hold, but it's about the vibrato. Yeah, does every singer really have a vibrato? Because I feel I don't have a vibrato because my type of voice is like a soft and like a falsetto. So sometimes I try to use the vibrato, but I think it's not like a vibrato, but it's just like my voice shaking.
Yeah, no, everybody should have a natural vibrato. Vibratos are very different. And sometimes you might have a vibrato and you don't think you have a vibrato. And sometimes you might have what you think is a vibrato, but it's really tension. So I want to hear you. That would be the next thing for next time. I'd like you to sing for me. But this exercise, that the big takeaway today, guys, is resonance. This idea of when you open everything up and you talk like this, there's a natural resonance. The more open and high your soft palate is, the more likely you are to find your natural vibrato. It's super important. Yes, it's Julia Child voice. You got it. That's exactly right. So I would encourage all of you for this week to just start to find that. We did that chewing exercise. That's also a way to find it very naturally. Just to feel that resonance, yeah? We're seeing some folks tomorrow for singing. So we'll be able to apply a lot of these principles. Thank you for bearing with me with this health session today that we did. But really starting next week, we'll get much more into the nitty gritty of the technique. And I will send out a couple of videos for analysis too. I'll be looking forward to hearing your analysis. Also, one important point. I'm very curious to hear more Indonesian singers. And I mean, among you, I want to hear songs in Indonesian. I want to hear, are there any pop singers I should know about? So please send me your recommendations also. This is a two-way street. Let's do our picture. I think we're going to do a picture before this ends.
Yes. Yeah. So for everyone who can turn on their camera. Okay. Hold on. I'm going to count in 3, 2, 1. All right. Next page, just put your best smile there. All right. another one and we're done. Thank you so much for attending today's class. Don't forget that we have another session tomorrow with Carla again, and have a nice rest, everyone. See you guys tomorrow. Bye-bye.
Just really quick, we do have a Spotify list. I saw that question in here. So we'll make sure that we get that to you guys. I made it collaborative. Let me see if I can put that in here. I just put a few songs in right now. So I invite you to please put your songs in the Spotify list. Let me put it in the chat. And here you go. Yeah, do you guys see it? Awesome. Okay, it looks like Grizzly is back. So I will wish you all a good night, and we'll see you tomorrow. Thank you so much. Oh, Grizzly.
Ooh, hello. Thank you so much, Carla.
Thank you so much.
Thank you
very much.
Nice day.
Thank you, Carla.
Good luck on your concert.
Thank you.
Carla, good luck.
Good luck, Carla. Bye.
Bye.